Hello everyone and welcome to another debriefing, this one brought to us by BradleyTank from the BC Tank Company. Not really familiar with them offhand, but there's so many out there I wouldn't really know. He's in the top of a tier 8 battle here, and the Crosshairman's a T-44 and a Carnivan, and he's joined by a Panther 2, so it's mediums against a medium and a heavy. So it could be pretty interesting. And then below that's a bunch of heavies on both sides, followed by the standard fluff of tank destroyers and whatnot else. No artillery, which actually does make a huge difference. So let's go take a look at this Super Pershing here. He's running actually a decent spread of AP, gold, and HE. I mean, he's actually running the perfect balance there. I would do maybe 5 gold, 5 HE, and then all the rest are into AP, but what he has there works just fine. I mean, as long as he has a couple extra gold just in case, that's all you really need. And now, as to where he's going, I don't know. Being a medium in this map, and I need to expand it real quick, there we go. So, being a Super Pershing on top of the tier like he is now, there's not a whole heck of a lot on the field that's going to really cause him too much of a headache. I'm trying to look at the other players' penetration rates, and it looks like from the front, almost everyone's going to have problems. They're all below 200, so they're going to need to get the weak spots of the tank, basically hitting the commander's hatch, which is above the little, let's see if I can rotate around it, above that little smokestack there. Shoot right through there, you'll hit the commander hatch. That's one of the weak spots of the tank. Anywhere else, there's spaced armor all around that turret. The front armor is ridiculous. The side armor is pretty good because it'll go mostly through the tracks, in which will take very little damage. So he's actually sitting up pretty high and mighty and shouldn't do too bad. The Carnivan, on the other hand, on the other side, is about the same. That thing actually might give him a run for his money. And then anything hitting his side, obviously, is going to give him a problem. Or anyone who's hitting the sweet spots, but I mean, he's sitting high and mighty. This match, I'd be pretty confident. And the sad part is, it might lend you to be a little ballsy, a little more than you should be in this sort of a match, because you want to play a little reserved. Knowing that you're top tier and you know you're not going to take too much damage means that you want to be the guy who can definitely make sure you win. You don't want to be the guy who rushes headlong into the fray and get yourself killed because you get flanked and whatnot else. Now, he's sitting out here in the middle. I'm probably chalking it up to the fact he's typing. That is a common occurrence. And I mean, if he was actually playing, he probably would be behind this rock or somewhere else. Yeah, as you see, he was talking there. And yeah, other than that, just he's playing it safe. He's kind of behind the lines. I don't know why he's running camel nets, other than the fact that, hey, why not? It might have been just a free slot he didn't fill up or hasn't had the cash to fill up yet. And so, I mean, why not? It works out for him. It's a medium tank, so he's going to get a pretty decent camel efficiency. He's running a little bit out there as far as I would prefer to. I mean, you could take the shots and try and finish off this this M10 Panzer, the Panther in disguise. He's more than meets the eye. And then beyond that, that's when you'd want to head back. Because they're not going to do too much, but the last thing you want to do is get yourself exposed, just out of habit. Again, you want to try and be that guy that's going to be able to take care of cleaning things up or holding a flank, which he's doing now. He can easily hold this flank, provided no one gets around to his side. And he fires fast enough, it shouldn't be too much of an issue. I kind of sit there in the bush and wait, and that's kind of what he's doing. He's playing his time, at least by the looks of it. I have to wait and see what he decides to do. It seemed as though there was a bunch of targets coming, so he definitely doesn't want to move by any means. If he moves forward, that's going to be suicidal if he caught the amount of tanks moving. And there we go, he's got the nice Carnivan charging at him. So at range, he might have the advantage if the thing starts charging at him, because he can backpedal a little bit on top of it. But the turret of that thing is going to be almost impossible to penetrate. And the nice thing is he's actually walking right into the open in front of all of the teammates there, and he's showing his side armor. The SU-125 with his derp cannon might be a different story. The last thing you want to do is take a shell from that thing. So if he presents himself, yeah, definitely lay into him like he's doing. That Carnivan, though, he's already lost the game for himself, and sadly, that's just the way it turned out. He rushed ahead like he shouldn't have, and he's firing at the front like that. He'll go through, but he's already taken way too much damage to really be too effective. That SU-152 is going to be the main threat. Oh, and he's running the 122. Oh, if he was running the 152, it'd be a completely different story. But sadly, he's not. And so, really, it's going to come down to that Carnivan if he wants to be able to do too much. And the Super Pershing should have it in a head-to-head fight at this point, because the Carnivon got aced earlier by all this other incoming fire, and so it's just going to be kind of lopsided, for lack of better terms, and so it's going to work out pretty good for him. Now, again, the trouble is going to be if anyone buys the flank random or hits any of the weak spots like the 29 just did. So luckily, the 29 was able to sneak in another shot there, but he's aiming and getting luck shots there. I'm surprised he actually went through. Hold on, let's wait for this 29 to die, and then I'll look and see if I can see where. Okay. So it looked like, he got one in right in the lower plate. Yeah, the lower plate is kind of fragile. It's just, it's crazy difficult to necessarily hit that at range. So playing the 20, or the Super Pershing at range definitely makes a big difference versus that close range like that, where they were able to walk into that weak spot of the tank, and that really did make a lot of difference. Let's go into a standard first person view. Yeah, he was able to hit the weak spots, which it was mostly because he was right on top of them, and that was more or less, had the Super Pershing thought about it, he could have either angled his tank a bit, he was kind of going flush on, or he could have started backing up, giving space, trading space for armor, which would have been a pretty decent idea too. Either way, it did work out. He took a lot more damage than he might have should have, or probably should have. And now they're reduced to, sadly, I hate to admit it, as much as I love the T-44, unless he uses his speed and gets up really close, the Super Pershing will have it. But then again, it'll take 3 shots for the 44 penetrating to kill it, whereas the Super Pershing would take as many as it has hit points. So it's kind of one of those things. I have no idea what's over there on that top flank over there. But there's an SU-100. He's probably not going to be able to do too much. And, of course, missing an opportunity here because he's busy typing. That's one thing I'd highly recommend being careful of, is typing. Is it'll oftentimes get you screwed. I've sometimes been a kind of a mean person and tricked people into responding to me from the enemy team. And when they were responding, I charged them and killed them. And, I mean, it's not a nice thing to do. And I've done it maybe 1 or 2 or 3 times. But every time you do it, it's kind of dirty. Just never... Again, this is my own personal preference. I don't type to anybody because it does expose you like that. And of course, not being in an artillery match, all the difference in the world. He doesn't have to worry about people ranging in on him and him having to constantly move. So, nice little benefit there. But it looks as though there's not too much that can oppose him. I don't know if I'd be hiding out there in the open. I would have just kind of cruised down to the K area. They're not really going to do too much, but the last thing you want is one good shell to get you and then knock you down to like 100 hit points. And so, yeah, he's... I would actually go into the hills. Because last thing, yeah, just like that, you don't want to get tracked and then have them start to get better angles on you. Any sort of crazy abilities. It's possible, it's unlikely, but it's still possible. And with... Oh, now he has the Panther 2 with him. Okay, now he's pretty much set. That Panther 2 is going to be his like nice little scouter. He's going to be just fine. And unless these two tanks decide to get up close, it's going to be... not much of a contest, per se. He's going to have the pin on them, he's going to have the range and the armor on them all. And that's, he's doing it right. He's playing it at long range, which is the way I've always... Ooh! He turned a little bit too much to the side. So that was a little rough. He shouldn't have probably turned to the side like that, but I mean, that was a risky chance that he might not have even known he had a shot coming at him. And, now it's a game. One shot can make all the difference in the world against him. So you should be really careful about turning that side. I was not expecting that, and that was coming in from a hidden target. So, that was a little rough there. The Super Pershing, yeah, now he's one-shottable to a good shot, or an HE shot, actually. One or two good ones can easily knock him down, and that's something that the other team and he needs to realize, that, you know, now he's greatly exposed. That shot to his side made all the difference in the world. He's taking a shot that he probably shouldn't have, and at least he's hidden at the moment, but with a 29 and an IS sitting there, it's going to be a little rough. So he needs to play that one cautiously, let his team do a little bit of lifting at this point. He's done pretty well, and now we'll just have to see what happens. That 29's looking a different way, but he really can't penetrate that turret, and the IS can see him. Ooh, got lucky there that he wasn't running HE. And then you just hit him with a standard shell. And of course, the IS is one capable tank of bouncing just as much as the Super Pershing here. So it's kind of a mixture of both are getting good luck against each other. And there we go. Penetrating him. I would not stay in the open like he's doing. I would backpedal, angle my tank a bit to get even more armor. Try and use that rock to my advantage. He's a little bit too exposed there for my tastes. I totally would have backed up, gotten alongside of that rock if it was me. That way it would have prevented any unnecessary damage if any were to occur. Of course, with the Super Pershing being as crazy powerful as it is, he had a pretty good chance of not having to deal with too much issue. And then, of course, his teammates rushed in, so he was safe, pulled for the win. I mean, I just would have done a few things differently, but he still did pretty well. So let's go ahead and take a peek at the screen cap, shall we? So not a bad game by any means, getting 70,000 credits and 57,000, 58,000 experience with Sniper, Steel Wall, and Spartan. Not bad. There was a few key little things I would have done differently, but he also was top dog, so there's not too much that he should be afraid of. And that's just the way that it ended up being with the matchmaker. It really benefited him. And all I can say is that BradleyTank kind of did, you know, it worked out really well for him. He did hold his flank the way he should have. He got lucky his team was in the right position at the right time, and that just he faced a lot of tanks that couldn't really do too much against him. So he got, there's a few shots he shouldn't have taken, but it's sometimes luck just works out that way. Anyway, not a bad game. I would have just played a little bit closer to the terrain, maybe not expose myself nearly as much, but that's to each individual person. So, thank you for sending this one in, BradleyTank. I hope you guys enjoyed this episode, and I will catch you in the next episode of my debriefings here. Thanks, guys. See you then.